Okay, so I hope you can hear me. Let me get started with the discussion. First of all, let me say that I wish I was there in person. Unfortunately, I tested positive for COVID on Monday with one of the university screening tests in the beginning of the semester. And I actually feel fine, but I have to isolate for 5 days. So I'll try to do my best giving the discussion in this forum, which is actually even not as good as just a Zoom. And I'm not the biggest fan of Zoom, as many of you know. But I'll try my best to go through it. So let me start saying that I think it's a very interesting paper. What I will try to do is give you a sense of what stablecoins are, how important they are, and what are some of the issues with policy and regulation that are being discussed. And then tell you what I think the paper is doing, kind of the gist of the paper, and some comments on what I think the authors may want to consider further. So, stablecoins, we know that financial technology that is on the rise is giving rise to attempts to create new forms of money, namely cryptocurrency. And the one that everyone knows very well, of course, is Bitcoin. There are many others. And we all know that one of the key problems of Bitcoin and some of the other cryptocurrencies is that they're extremely volatile. And that makes it very hard to use them for transactions. So more recently, something new emerged, a new type of cryptocurrency, and we call it a stablecoin, and there are many of them now. And basically, the stablecoins are trying to solve this issue and provide stable value with respect to a fiat currency, say the US dollar. And the stability, as Simon was discussing, is meant to be maintained via a platform that keeps some reserves and an equity cushion and is conducting transactions to keep the exchange rate of the stablecoin fixed with respect to the dollar. Now, this has been really a huge phenomenon. So this is from a recent blog post of Cecchetti and Scheinholz. They write a lot of good posts on financial fragility, and they wrote one focusing on stablecoins. And you can see here the enormous growth of stablecoins. What is most surprising in this graph is really the x-axis. We're just looking from January 20 to October 21 and look at the huge growth. And it continued to grow since then. So, you know, we're talking now almost $200 billion. So it's really sort of a big thing. Tether is the biggest one, but there are others as well. When you look at what they actually do, and this is an important component of the paper, you know, they keep different kinds of assets. This is from Tether. And, you know, only 40% of the assets that they have is cash equivalents. The others have some level of risk, some more, some less. But you have commercial paper and corporate bonds and others. And basically, the fact that there is some risk in the reserves create some fluctuations and some challenge for maintaining the fixed rate. So based on all this, there is a growing concern of fragility. And when you take a step back, this is not a hugely new type of fragility. Whenever we have an arrangement that aims to maintain a stable payment against some potentially risky assets, you have this kind of fragility that emerges. And, you know, the nature of the financial system is that it's trying to do a lot of these things. So bank deposits come to mind, currency pegs come to mind, and so on and so forth. And here, when I'm talking about currency pegs, I'm talking about the traditional currency pegs. So here are a couple of quotes recently from policy discussions on the stable coins. If stablecoin issuers do not honor a request to redeem a stablecoin, or if issuers lose confidence in a stablecoin issuer's ability to honor such a request, runs on the arrangement could occur that may result in harm to users and the broader financial system. This is from a report on stablecoins by the president's working group on financial market. And then Jerome Powell recently in the Senate Banking Committee says, my point with stablecoin was that they are like money funds, they are like bank deposits, and they're going incredibly fast, but without appropriate regulation, if we are going to have something that looks just like a money market fund or a bank deposit or a narrow bank, and it's going really fast, we really ought to have appropriate regulation, and today we don't. Okay, so that's a huge issue nowadays in policy. So what is the story of the paper? So, you know, I sort of set it up that the typical issue of fragility people think about is runs, but actually the paper stays away from that. And that's going to be one of my comments. But they are highlighting a different type of fragility that is not a run. They basically say that runs are ruled out because the platform is over-collateralized. And the fragility that comes up here is that the stablecoin issuer starts to be low on reserves and then pushes the risk to the investors and lets the value of the currency fluctuate. So basically, the issuer doesn't want to go into liquidation, and then it basically debases the currency, the exchange rate, and this creates instability for stablecoins. Okay. So even though we don't have liquidation, we still have the instability. And then the authors discuss various policy interventions and show that one in particular looks promising. This is capital requirements that implies that stablecoin issuers are going to be less likely to reach the unstable region. So this is the basic structure. I think I can skip that. Simon discussed that. I'll just say, you know, you have the assets, the reserves on the liability side. You have the commitment to the stablecoin holders. And then you have the governance tokens, which are basically the equity cushion. If reserves decrease, the equity cushion can absorb that. And you can do all sorts of things with the stablecoin without changing the value of the coin. But at some point, if reserves decrease too much and you are afraid that you're going to lose your equity, then you basically debase the stable coin. And this is the kind of dynamics that we get out of the model. So if you look here on the upper left panel, you basically see that excess reserves are fluctuating all the time. But for a long time, they can fluctuate and you can still maintain a fixed token price. At some point, they decrease enough that you start letting the token price fluctuate as well. And with it also, you see a decrease in the token supply and the total token usage, which is the token price times the token supply. So this is this was a summary of the paper. Let me now give you four sets of comments that I would urge the authors to think about. I'll start with number one here, thinking about the key ingredients of the model. I'll say that the model has a lot of moving parts. So it's really not an easy model to keep track of. But if you want to sort of go to the essence of it and understand sort of the key building blocks, I think it's important to look here at the flow utility that investors are getting from holding the coins. And here U is the amount that they hold in coins. N is the total amount in circulation in dollar terms in the system. And then here, sigma is basically the volatility, the current volatility of the value of the coin, okay? And you can basically see that according to the authors, users are getting a higher utility from their coins when there are more coins in circulation. This is N here. These are the network externalities. They're getting a lower utility when current volatility is higher. And then they also say that the value of holding the coin enters non-linearly here and linearly here. Those are sort of the ingredients of the flow utility from coins. What I would suggest that the authors do is to better motivate these ingredients and sort of follow through on how each and every one affects the final results. And the reason that I'm saying that is that, you know, this is not the most standard building block of a model. And it raises questions where exactly it's coming from. So I understand the idea of network externalities, for example, but why do you care about the dollar value in circulation? That's not obvious. At the end of the day, you care about how many coins are there, not necessarily the dollar value. You care about your ability to conduct transactions, and that is not captured here very clearly. Also, when you think about this utility here coming from the volatility, when I think about how the volatility here should affect the utility, you think that people who hold these coins, they say, you know, when I want to use it, I don't want it to fluctuate. So then you would care more than just about the current instantaneous volatility, but you would care about the possibility for fluctuations down the road. And this is not captured here as well. So I would say, you know, go back to sort of micro foundations and try to motivate exactly what you have, and also try to show us how these ingredients are then mapped to the results. Taking a step back, I will say what was missing to me is also to understand exactly what is the value creation here that is done by the platform, by the stablecoin issuer. So if you think about investors who have this kind of utility, what do they do if they don't go into the stablecoin? They will use dollars and so on, and then compare what is the utility they get there versus what is the utility they get here. I think that would be important to understand overall what the stablecoin is doing and what it cannot do. So that's my first set of comments. Second set of comments is to think more about the key mechanism in the paper and think about how unique it is to stablecoins, and also to some extent, how relevant it is to stablecoins. And I think this kind of discussion was also missing in the paper. So first of all, I would say the key mechanism in the paper, the idea that the stablecoin issuer is going to debase the currency and move some of the fluctuations to investors instead of absorbing them, this does not necessarily depend on the key ingredients that I mentioned before, the network externality and the disutility from fluctuations. In other words, you would get this kind of dynamics, I suspect, in other more standard models. And I think this is important to understand. And then it's important to understand what do we get from these other features. The other thing to note is, you know, the authors kind of say that this is something special about stablecoin and we don't see it in other types of intermediation problems, but it's not necessarily true. You can think about any typical financing problem, and then once you have something like debt renegotiation or debt haircuts, this will kind of generate this kind of debasement that we see here. So I will say it does echo some of the things we see in other contexts. And finally, if we think about how relevant this is in the particular context of stablecoins, I would say, you know, I'm not sure stablecoins would thrive under this idea that at the end of the day, they are not stable. So if you go into a stablecoin and you know that when you need it, it's going to start fluctuating, it kind of defeats the whole purpose of a stablecoin to begin with. So I'm not even sure that this is what we will see stablecoins developing into. And if they do, then I'm not sure they would be that useful. Third set of comments is about runs. And you know, when I think about it, I thought runs would be the major financial fragility problem. I think this is also echoed in the policy debate. The authors kind of push it aside, saying, you know, we have over-collateralization, and as a result, there will not be runs. But I would push against that. I think I would still expect runs to come up in the framework, even in the current framework of the paper, even with over-collateralization. And I think the authors should do more to convince us that they are not there, or maybe just bring them in. So one thing that I think happens is you know, if you think about investors in a dynamic framework, when they think that debasement of the currency is coming, this is when they will start running. This is what we know from models of speculative attacks against traditional currencies. I'm not sure why this doesn't happen in the model. My understanding is that the authors just don't consider that, but I think if you allow that to happen, it could happen. There is actually another kind of run that would happen given the ingredients that the authors have, and this is solely from the network externalities. Remember that the value of using this stable coin is increasing when more other people are using it. This in itself generates strategic complementarity that could lead to a run. The authors have one footnote where they kind of discuss it briefly, but not more than that. And finally, the last thing is, even if you have the over-collateralization, you have to remember that the assets are not very liquid. There is a liquidity / safety mismatch. And this is the kind of financial intermediation problem that we know that is generating the dynamics for Iran. And here, you know, they say, well, the value of the assets is higher than the value of the liability, so we're not going to get into that. But remember, if the assets are not fully liquid, then you might get into problems of runs. So overall, I would say, I think runs are still here, even in the current framework. And I would suggest maybe discussing them more. The last thing, I will just mention a few brief thoughts and then conclude. One thing to note about stable coins, you know, their potential is great and everything, but so far, they are not really used for actual transactions. They're used for speculating with other cryptocurrencies and so on. So it, in some sense, it's not really taking off the way people thought it would. And this may inform the way that utility from them is modeled. Second, I think that the role of regulation in the paper is not always clear. For example, if you think about the reserve requirement, this is something that the stablecoin issuer itself can actually commit to doing. So the stablecoin issuer can say, you know, we are committing to higher capital and then charge an upfront fee to compensate themselves for the cost that this will have. So it's not clear here why the government needs to step in the model. Third, I think one of the things that we see that is very interesting these days is that more stable coins are emerging, and then we need to think more about the competition between them and the system equilibrium that could arise. I think that would be very interesting. Finally, a more technical comment on the model. There are many moving parts, and I think the story behind how fluctuations are transferred to the investors is overall clear. However, there are many other things that are determining the fluctuations in the price and the fluctuations in the supply, and those are sometimes difficult to keep track of. So I would encourage the authors to improve the transparency of all the dynamics that are going on. So let me conclude. I think there is no doubt that stable coins are becoming important and the concerns for fragility are mounting. The paper offers an extensive analysis of an interesting mechanism for fragility. They are not looking at runs, which is something that I think a lot of people are talking about, but rather they are talking about something else, that the stablecoin issuer is going to debase the coin value when the reserves are depleted. I think it's interesting overall, certainly well done, but I would encourage the authors to think more. First, how unique or relevant this mechanism is. Second, what some of the basic modeling assumptions capture exactly. And finally, some of the broader issues about fragility and regulation of stablecoins. So I'll stop here. Thank you.